Hi there, welcome to the new video. Today we'll be doing a walkthrough of a survey paper that talks about ways to evaluate the text generation systems. It's from authors from Microsoft Research and University of Washington. It was released this year itself, which means it covers almost all the advances that have been happening in this space. So since it's a survey paper, as expected, it's very extensive. It's around 55 to 60 pages long. So I'll be dividing the content of this video in 3 to 4 videos based on the chapters that authors have mentioned under the index section. Hope you'll enjoy watching it. So yeah, having said that, if you have watched any of my previous content and have gained some value, I would encourage you to hit that subscribe button and share it across. The paper surveys evaluation methods of NLG systems that have been developed in the last few years. So these are the three categories or the three chapters that I was talking about. So in this video, I'll be covering human-centric evaluation metrics. In the next video, I'll be talking about automatic metrics that doesn't require any training data set, which will mostly include Rouge, Blue, Meteor, F-score, and all those metrics. And the last video will be based on machine learned metrics, where we essentially train a system that learns how to evaluate the NLG systems. One of which I have already reviewed. It was called BLIRT. I've made a video on that. If you want, you can check that out as well. I'll put that link in the description as well as in the I button. Okay, so moving forward. Okay, so to give an example of what NLG system looks like, you can think of translation systems where you are given a source language S and you train a system that basically transforms it to some target language T. Or you can think of summarization systems, you can think of question generation systems, and so on and so forth. So it need not necessarily be that you generate a text from the text source only. You could even have a system that generates text from a tabular data. So you can think of building a system that takes a table as an input and generates the description of it. So author says the ultimate goal of NLG is to generate text that is valuable to the people. So yeah, this is pretty true, because you can think of whether you're building a summarization system or translation systems or any other kind of a system. Ultimately, it will be consumed by humans either as a direct source or as an indirect source. So for this reason, human evaluations are typically viewed as the most important form of evaluation. So these are considered as gold standard in case you are trying to evaluate on some automatic metrics such as Rouge, Blue, and many others. So they found that many NLG papers include some form of human evaluation. Like out of 26, 20 papers published in ACL 2018 had human evaluation results. So this is more or less like giving an extra validation to your results, because most of the evaluation metrics are mostly around some kind of a similarity measure, maybe at vector form or maybe just at phrase level overlap. So doing an extra check at a human level, if that correlates to what you get at automatic evaluations, you're definitely going to get extra brownie points for that. Okay, let's move forward. But yeah, as expected, human evaluations will have several challenges. They will be expensive, they'll be time consuming, and the people who are going to evaluate will require extensive domain expertise. Although to ease out this process a bit, you have some crowdsourcing platforms like Amazon Mechanical Turk, where you can like post your results with proper description to how people are going to annotate, and based on certain voting, you can get your results. But again, that also has its own demerits, such as checking the quality of the evaluations and evaluators. Also, since you'll not be knowing who are the people who have evaluated your stuff, for that reason, this paper mentioned like most of the NLG papers from ACL and INLG. From that, only 55% of the papers report the number of participants in their human evaluations. Rest, you can think like 45% of the time you do not know how many people have evaluated. So that is actually a bit of a risky situation. So some of the common approaches that researchers take to evaluate the generated text is into intrinsic and extrinsic evaluations. Okay, so let's see what these things are. Okay, so which means, let's say you have an example X. You give this X to some Y number of people to evaluate independently on fluency, coherency, correctness, and all such measures. And this is usually done using Likert or sliding scale, where you kind of quantize all the values against the attributes for which you are trying to evaluate that generated text. Okay, so as you can see in this figure 2.1, this is a Likert scale question. So for any given text, if informativeness, naturalness, and quality, if these three things were supposed to be marked, you are given a scale of 6, where 1 means very low quality and 6 would mean very high quality. So in this format, you would essentially do the markings. Okay, so the approach that we just discussed, which was about using some scale to judge any sample X, it is just giving the sense of absolute quality of the generated text rather than some relative quality, where you try to compare against the baseline or some model variants that produce the similar text.
So for achieving the same, RankME is the method that people use, which essentially adds a magnitude estimation to the ranking task, where you basically ask the evaluators to indicate how much better their chosen text is over all the alternatives. So you might have already noticed the difference. In the previous case, we were independently ranking each of the samples, irrespective of what other methods are generating.
Okay. So we'll see what RankME is as we go forward.
Then author gives an example of the translation system, where one of the methods that people usually use is called adequacy. That basically measures how much meaning from the Google translation is also expressed in the translated version.
So definitely the annotators or the evaluators have to be bilingual. They should understand the source language as well as the target language to be a better judge in such kind of a task.
The second metric that people usually use when doing human evaluation in case of machine translation systems is called fluency, where the translated sentence is measured independently and doesn't depend on its source sentence. So in this criteria, you basically look out for if the grammar is correct, the spellings are okay, what style are we trying to portray, what are the choice of words that we have taken. So all of these 4 or 5 factors essentially combine and we call it as fluency.
So a very common question, how we evaluate this, is by asking a question to every human evaluator: is the language of the output fluent? And then you might think of having a Likert scale where you have a quantized value from minimum to maximum. Okay, moving forward.
So in case of summarization systems or in systems where you're trying to generate text for given data or let's say of table, then factuality is one of the parameters that people usually look out for, which basically accounts for if the facts that are mentioned in the input are portrayed correctly in the output. So as an example, you can think of a news article where some date, let's say 1957, was mentioned. Now if your model outputs 1928 with some incorrect context, then that output will be said to be factually wrong. So in these cases, a copy mechanism is usually used that helps us to take a call between if you want to go with the model in a generative mode or you want to copy certain pieces of text from the input. So yeah, there has already been a lot of work that is done in this domain. I'll try to link some of the papers in the description. Do check them out.
Okay. So all of these citations basically found out that 70% of the generated single sentence summary contained hallucinations, which means they were generating some false information and were factually incorrect. So now talking about the tasks such as where you want to extend a given piece of text, let's say story generation, where you are already provided with a certain premise and you want to extend it to generate the entire story. In those cases, coherency or consistency are major factors that come into play while you are evaluating those systems, because you'll definitely not want the plot to change totally as you progress forward in the story. So those things have to be intact. So one more dimension that you can focus to judge the generated text is to find the style in which it is generated. So which means basically given a piece of text, you could even generate something that sounds like more of a social media post. You can also convey the same thing in a bookish language, or even you can convey the same thing maybe let's say in Shakespeare writing style. So that is also one of the things that you might want to focus. So that's what they have written: overall style, formality and tone.
Okay.
Moving forward. Okay, so now we are done with the intrinsic evaluations. Now talking about extrinsic evaluations.
So these evaluations are done by evaluating the performance of some downstream task. So what do I mean by that is, consider you have n data points and you want to cluster these points. Let's say you choose k-means as your algorithm of choice and you get some k-clusters. Now the point is, how do you evaluate the quality of these clusters? So there also you have two mechanisms: intrinsic evaluation and extrinsic evaluation. So extrinsic evaluation in that case would be, you take these clusters, send them to some network, let's say n, and you have a classification task of let's say 0 and 1. So based on the accuracy of what this model gets, will define how good were the features or how good were the clusters that you have generated. So that is the measure which we call as extrinsic evaluation. Whereas intrinsic evaluation is self-contained and its evaluation is not dependent on the performance of any other downstream task.
Okay. Next, we discuss what we call as inter-evaluator agreement. So this is a measure usually used to calculate an agreement score between the evaluators for the evaluations that they're doing. Since the complexity of the task is really high and the model is generative in nature, so you'll definitely find disagreement within the evaluators. So the higher level of inter-evaluator agreement would mean that the task is well defined, the instructions were given properly to all of the evaluators and they have understood it, and also the text that got generated from our system was consistent. Whereas if the inter-evaluator agreement is low,
then that could signify that the task was not well defined, instructions were not given well, evaluators were a little confused while doing the evaluations, and it could also be that the text generated by a system was itself not reliable. So there are certain formulas that you use to calculate this score. So let's see those things. So the first one is called percentage agreement,
which is actually a very simple measure, and it just measures the percentage of cases where evaluators agree with each other. So for example, if you have a set of X test sentences where each of the sample is given by Xi and Ai be the agreement score for each of the sample, so this will be assigned as 1 if evaluators agree, and it will be assigned as 0 if they don't. So in the numerator, you simply sum wherever the people have agreed divided by total number of samples. So you can see if P is equal to 0, which means none of the evaluators agree to the score for the generated text. Whereas if P is equal to 1, which means all of them agree to all of the samples. Whereas there is a catch in this formulation, which is mentioned by this paper, which is that it does not take into account the fact that the evaluators may purely agree by chance. So yeah, that is also true. So for that purpose, we introduce what we call as Cohen's Kappa. So here, in addition to PA, what we just saw, which was the percentage based thing, you also calculate PC, which is the probability of evaluators agreeing by chance. So let's say you have two evaluators, E1 and E2, where P of S given E1 is nothing but probability of giving a score S by the evaluator E1. And similarly, this talks about probability of giving a score S by the evaluator E2. Okay, so they have given example as well. So let's say there are just two scores, 0 and 1. And there were 10 examples that two evaluators had to evaluate. So E1 has given 6 scores to the zeros and 4 scores to 1. And similarly, E2 has given its number. So you can see the way PC is calculated, you have 0.6 into 0.5, because 6 out of 10 times E1 has given score 0, where E2 has given score 0 with 5 out of 10 times. So you multiply again by 5 divided by 10 and you have this number. And similarly, you can calculate this, then you have the summation. So this is the formula how we calculate Cohen's Kappa, where you can see like PA varies from 0 to 1. So when PA is equal to 1, your Kappa becomes 1, and as it gets below PC, you'll have a Kappa value of negative. So which means your Kappa ranges from negative values to a maximum value of 1. And the closer it is to 1, the agreement is said to be higher. Okay, so moving to another matrix, what we call as Fly's Kappa. So Cohen's Kappa usually works when you have two evaluators, whereas Fly's Kappa extends this limitation and works when you have multiple evaluators that score the generated text. So this is mostly used in crowdsourcing platforms, one of which we discussed, which was Mechanical Turk. Okay. So we have already seen that Ai is nothing but the agreement score for the text Xi from the set of capital X. So this is a formulation how you calculate Ai in this case. So you calculate all the pairs of evaluators that you can find from the set of evaluators. And then for some score S, you sum all of these numbers. And then you divide by total number of evaluator pairs that you have formed. So with this, you get an agreement score for every sample. Then you define the probability of agreement, which is nothing but the average that you take across all the text, which we saw in equation 2.1. So yeah, exactly. So this is the formula that you'll use then. The last thing that the authors discuss is what we call as Krippendorf's alpha. So whatever measures we have seen so far give equal weightage to all the disagreements. But there could be some cases where we wish to penalize some agreements more harshly than others. So this method basically is used for that purpose. They also define a weight W associated to every disagreement. And also, this method works at evaluating the disagreement rather than calculating the agreement. So in this again, we need to calculate two values, PD and PC, where PD is the probability of disagreement and PC is the probability of chances, what we have been seeing for all the methods. So here in PD, you count the evaluator pairs that assign a pair of score that is different or could be same to some sample Xi. So you count those number of evaluators pair who have given, let's say, score of 0 and score of 1, or maybe score of 0 and score of 2, all of these different pairs over here, and you sum it for all the number of samples that you have. So this was the weight that I was talking about. So this gets multiplied to every element over here, and then you divide by total number of evaluator pairs. So if M is equal to N, which means both the scores were same, then you give weight is equal to 0. Simply because if M is equal to N, then this is a condition of agreement, but this method just focuses on disagreement, so we are discarding that element from the summation.
And again, P of C, which is the probability of chances, is calculated in the same format what we just saw in Fly's Kappa. Okay. Yeah, so I guess we are done with the first section of this survey paper now. So in the next video, I'll talk about the automatic evaluation matrix. Let me just show you things I'll be covering first. So I'll be talking about n-gram matrix, such as blue, rouge, meteor, and all of these things. Then I'll be talking about distance-based matrix, such as edit distance, vector similarity. Then diversity matrix, such as self blue. And then semantic content match matrix, such as pyramid, spider, and so on. And lastly, we'll be ending with syntactic similarity-based matrix. So yeah, all of that will be covered in the next video. If you like this video, make sure you hit that like button and subscribe to the channel, and do share it with your friends if they are interested in such content. I'll meet you in the next one. Bye.